Hello, I'm Elliott Antman, President of the American Heart Association. We're here again for AHA Science News in sunny Barcelona at the European Society of Cardiology annual meeting. And we're here to discuss some interesting observations from Hotline III, heart failure, devices, and interventions. I'm joined by Dr. Mariell Jessup, who is our immediate past president, and Dr. Frank Sellke, who's about to become the chair of our Committee on Scientific Sessions programs. So, Frank, tell us about the ANTHEM study. What were the investigators looking at, and what did they find?
Well, a component to heart failure is a dysregulation of autonomic output. The theory is that if you can increase parasympathetic output, it actually may improve patient condition. It was a relatively small trial in which right versus left vagal pacing was performed, and there was a slight increase in ejection fraction after about 6 months. It increased by 4.5% in both groups. However, the problem with the study, there was no control group, so it's difficult to make a definite conclusion whether this therapy actually worked.
So, Mariell, this was a comparison of right versus left vagal stimulation, and as Frank just told us, there was no control group. And the other day, you chaired a session where the Nectar HF trial was presented. Could you remind us about that and the difference here with ANTHEM?
So in Nectar HF, they did primarily right vagal stimulation, completely all right, but they had patients, everyone got the stimulator, but they compared it to half the patients while the stimulation was off and the other half were on. So there was a comparator. There was absolutely no signal of efficacy in Nectar HF, nothing. And so the real question then is, what did they do differently in ANTHEM compared to Nectar? And I think we have a lot more to learn about this technique if we're going to see the efficacy. I did ask the investigator, because a lot of this data comes from animal models, and in animal models with vagal stimulation, they saw an impact on beneficial remodeling of the heart very early. So if we're going to see something, we should see it fairly quickly in the human model, if you will.
So we have to worry about which vagus is being stimulated, and certainly the stimulation protocol itself seems quite important here. And it reminds us of the importance of having some control group if we're going to be able to interpret these data optimally. And there were a number of other presentations in Hotline III that dealt with cardiac resynchronization therapy. One dealt with biventricular versus RV pacing in patients who had AV block. That was the BIOPACE study. And then there was one comparing septal versus RV apical stimulation. And that was a study that just gave us some information about the difference of the positioning leads. Let's start with BIOPACE. I know you reviewed that.
So BIOPACE was really answering the question, what kind of pacing you should do in somebody that has AV block. We heard an earlier study last year looking at the same patient population, block HF. That study, block HF, was a very remarkable demonstration of what we all expected, that CRT would do better than RV pacing. Interesting, in the current study, we didn't see that dramatic of effect. It was trending towards significance, but Frank, I don't know what they said in the discussion about why this trial was not as successful.
Well, they didn't really come up with a good explanation. There was no difference up to about 5 years, and there was a slight trend after that. What was remarkable was the complication rate in the biventricular pacing group was much higher. There was a failure of lead placement up to 14 or 15% in the biventricular pacing group versus no problem in the RV lead pacing group, and the infection rate was considerably higher for the biventricular pacing. They didn't really come up with a good explanation for this, but I think it's somewhat against conventional wisdom.
Right.
We did discuss a study that was presented earlier in the week that looked at a new quadrupolar catheter for stimulating the LV, and that expands the number of options for the bipolar stimulation that you need, and maybe something like that would be helpful in the future for CRT.
That was called more CRT.
More CRT.
Easy to remember.
Appropriately named. Then there was this one that looked at septal versus apical piercing. Frank, can you tell us a little bit about that one?
Well, it was a study comparing a mid-septal lead placement versus apical lead placement.
In the RV?
In the right ventricle. And there was some concern that apical chronic atrial pacing will lead to left ventricular dysfunction long-term. However, there was absolutely no difference demonstrated between the two approaches.
How long were the patients followed in that study? Was it long enough to see this left ventricular dysfunction develop?
I think it was about 5 years. So I think if there was a difference, there should have
it should have appeared by then. And the last one that we'd like to discuss is the STAR AF trial. And this looked at a couple of different ways to ablate atrial fibrillation. So, Frank, I know you paid careful attention to that one. Can you tell us what they investigated?
Well, they looked at the effects of various interventions on chronic atrial fibrillation. The first one, what was kind of an aside, actually, was just pulmonary vein isolation. What they really wanted to compare was pulmonary vein isolation plus EKG fractionated therapy versus additional ablation lines. But they thought they would do the isolated pulmonary vein isolation just as another comparator to demonstrate that the other two methods were actually superior. To their surprise, however, the two more complex procedures were not quite as good. There was no statistical difference between these methods and pulmonary vein isolation. But they certainly were not better than just pulmonary vein isolation. What was also remarkable that the operator time was considerably greater for the more complex procedures versus pulmonary vein isolation, and the radiation time was 40% greater. So there may not be any benefit to doing the more complicated ablation procedures versus just pulmonary vein isolation, but there may be a downside in terms of time in the procedure room and also radiation exposure.
So, Frank, being a cardiac surgeon, I imagine at times you've been called upon intraoperatively to do basically a MACE procedure intraoperatively, and maybe a simpler approach, just pulmonary vein isolation, could be something that you can
Well, there's actually a trial ongoing sponsored by the Cardiothoracic Surgical Network. It's an NHLBI-sponsored trial looking at that very topic. Is pulmonary vein isolation not as good as a more complex procedure? That trial is still ongoing, but we should know fairly soon what the results will be.
Mariell, this has been a tremendous week for heart failure investigations. Any closing comments you have about the things we've discussed previously and the things we just talked about today?
I think success breeds more success. And I think once we've opened up the floodgates and said, this is a disease where we have more things to try. So, for example, even after the Nectar HF study was negative, there was still a lot of enthusiasm to say, well, we may not have it right, and there are things we can do, and so there's some optimism, which is really exciting.
Very nice to see. Well, we'll be sure to report back for our AHA Science News as more information becomes available here at the ESC Congress in Barcelona. I'd like to thank Dr. Jessup and Dr. Sellke for joining me, and thank you for watching.